The Democrats have been speeding up this impeachment process. And of course, that has put that whole conversation with respect to USMCA, I guess, on the back burner. So what's going on with that deal now?
I don't think it's on the back burner yet. I do think it's, you know, it's a cloudier sort of environment for the USMCA to pass. But I still think that if it is going to pass, it's going to pass this fall. Because essentially the Democrats haven't done anything since they retook Congress last fall. And lots of presidents have been reelected campaigning against a do-nothing Congress. So it's not, obviously the impeachment context makes things more difficult to pass it. But I think all sides have some interest in still seeing something done. Trump would love to have something to say he did something notwithstanding the impeachment. And I think Nancy Pelosi, the Speaker of the House, has an incentive to say that she accomplished something. So I still think, while it's not 100% sure it's going through, I still think there's the window hasn't completely closed on USMCA yet, and we'll have to wait and see. Obviously, if the impeachment situation gets really heated and shuts down all of proceedings in the legislature, sort of in Congress, then I think that's a different context. I don't think we're there yet.
In terms of that path for re-election for the president. I mean, he's still dealing with all these, I guess, trade wars, if you will. There's Mexico, Canada, of course, the EU, China. What is that path for re-election for him?
So they're different in different contexts. I think it's difficult to see a complete resolution of the Chinese trade dispute. I think not just Trump, but I think the American Congress wants to see more substantive changes than I think the Chinese are willing to do. We might be able to see some sort of a limited pullback. I think we're beginning to see signs of that in terms of agriculture, in terms of the Chinese buying more agricultural goods. But I think it's unlikely that before the election campaign, we'll see a complete resolution of that issue, in part because, and this is something I think gets lost in Canada a lot, is it's not just Trump. There's a sort of bipartisan consensus on China across the United States, and that if Trump were to actually sort of say, throw up his hands and say, I'm not going to go for a tough agreement, lots of Democrats, some of whom are actually running for president, would attack him. And others, maybe even his own party, like Senator Marco Rubio of Florida, would attack him. So I don't think we're going to see that. And I don't think the Chinese are ready to move to the substantive sort of change that Trump would like to see. So I think we might see something narrow, but we also see other pressures. I think we can continue to see Trump and others pushing to increase the issues like stock exchange. Can Chinese companies have access to U.S. exchanges? I mean, there's a threat about that recently as well. I think we can see some action on something like that as well.
You just mentioned House Speaker Nancy Pelosi and the Democrats, and I'm just wondering, it's in their best interest, undoubtedly, to legislate something during the impeachment process, isn't it?
Yeah, I think that's true. And if you go back to the actual NAFTA vote when President, not President Clinton, if you go back to the actual voting on some of these things before, that not all legislative actions changed or stopped abruptly while Clinton was being impeached. There are some things that began and then continued on afterwards. So I think that we will, I think essentially the thing to remember here is that some of the Democrats who were elected in districts that Trump won. And if the Democrats have any prospect of holding the Congress after the 2020 elections, they have to win those kind of Democratic seats. And so they're, on the one hand, those Democratic Congress people have said, look, we're willing to entertain an impeachment. They weren't prepared to do that a while ago. They said, we're prepared to do that. Now she's got to give them something back. It seems to me what one of the things she can give them back is, I'll let you have your vote on NAFTA to say you did something. Remember, these are people who didn't want to vote for impeachment because they were afraid of Trump's popularity in their home districts. That's why I think, despite all the sound and fury, despite what we might actually want to have, a lot of people in Canada, I think, would be quite happy if Trump didn't see this go through and just stayed with the status quo. Despite that, I still think the better money is on something happening, absent a complete implosion of the American political system, which I just don't think we're there yet.
Last year, we saw the ratification of the CPTPP. And of course, this year, there's a lot of talk in terms of a U.S.-Japan trade deal. What is the impact on Canadian exporters there?
So I think the essential thing is that the CPTPP, or the Comprehensive and Progressive TPP, which Obama had signed, Canada has a supposedly an advantage over the United States in sort of access to certain agricultural markets, principally for beef and for pork and things like that, into countries like Japan, but other members of, you know, in, of Asian economies. So what Japan has done is essentially done a deal with Trump, a side deal, which would say, well, you're not going to re-enter TPP, remembering that Trump formally got out of the TPP, but as I always note for people, it was never submitted to Congress for a vote, so it's not as if the Americans were actually ever in it. You know, formally, it would never have passed the Congress. I think most people know that. So what does it mean for Canadian exporters? I think we're going to compete more against American producers. I mean, there's a set of technical legal questions that people like me will argue about and look into, which is to what extent this breaks the rules of the WTO in terms of being a side agreement. Normally, a side agreement has to cover substantially all trade. This agreement clearly does not. Who's going to object to it? Will Canada object to it? Will other members of the CPTP countries object to it? But it does. There are other markets that are left open, notwithstanding the side deal that's been done. So my guess is everybody will hold their breath and let it go through and just move on to fight another day.
I know that you've been probably keeping up with election party platforms with the election just around the corner. The Liberals recently announcing that they are going to impose a tax on these digital giants like Amazon, Facebook, Netflix, and Apple. What do you make of that?
Well, it's early days, and I think we have to, you know, sort of weed through and figure out exactly what they mean. They may not tell us exactly what they mean until after the election. But I think, look, the French have acted unilaterally and passed something which totally upset Donald Trump, and he brought a Section 301 that's a really tough enforcement action against France, which the French thought they managed to get stalled during the last G7 meetings, and Trump said, no, it's not stalled, I'm still thinking of it. If Canada were to act preemptorily and unilaterally and follow the French, as some reports suggest that the Liberals are proposing, that I think would have exactly the same response that Trump had to the French. That's why I don't think it'll happen. If you actually read what's in the Liberal platform, they seem to suggest that they want to work through the OECD, which is in fact what Canada agreed to do as part of the G7 in the last meetings. And my guess is, when all the sound and fury settled, that basically, if the Liberals are reelected, they will continue to work through the OECD to do that and will not act preemptorily.